come to worship together in the Lord's house. There's no other name than the name of Jesus. He's going to share some news with us. This is Brother Vance, our associate. The youth is our student. They've been working on a plan. I'm going to let them share about what's going on with our youth.
Good morning. Welcome to God's house this morning. Just want to share a little bit of information with you about the student ministry, the youth ministry, and the direction we're headed. We have come up with an identity for the youth. They have something they can call their own. Some of you have already seen it, but the ones that haven't been informed yet, when y'all start seeing this, y'all know what it is now. It's our student ministry here at Centerville Baptist Church, Navigator Student Ministry. We tied it in with the church logo, and the theme is kind of our theme and motto. We're going to be navigating through God's Word together when we meet on Sundays and Wednesdays. And when you hear the compass, or meet us at the compass is our new name for our student building, where we meet every Sunday and Wednesday. So I just want to throw that information out there and let you know that when y'all see this, hear this, it's our youth here at the church. And somebody asks you about it, you be able to invite their kids or grandkids to the Navigator Student Ministry here at Centerville Baptist Church. Also, too, they get a monthly newsletter now with the upcoming activities. And if y'all would like to see that, it's on our youth bulletin board every month. So stop by and take a look at that. Thank you. And putting your trust in us to be a part of the youth of this church. Thank you.
Compass. The compass is like the Word of God. It can come to get the Word and go in the right direction in life. So I thank you, Brother Matt, and Navigators. All right. Also, if you're here for the first time and you're our special guest, feel free to fill out a visitor's card in the pew in front of you, drop it off an hour late, a little later in the service, and let us know you were here. And you're always with us. Welcome to come and worship with us anytime. Thank you for being with us this morning. Let's take this time to greet one another as we continue to worship this morning.
Bye. And I ask this all in your Lord's name. Amen.
sick today, so they're going to postpone their special visit for next week, Lord willing. But we do this today as Grandparents Day. We've got time to do that anyway. I can still preach and still get out before midnight. Okay? I'm just teasing you. But before we do that, if you notice on the communion table, there are two cards on each corner. As you know, we have an area to go out recently in the last couple of weeks. The Lord's blessed us in the sense that we gave that need to the Lord, and God helped provide that need in 5 days, basically roughly a week. People from outside the community gave, you gave, and we had a couple of churches that gave to the help us sister churches. And so one is Concord, and the other is New Life. And so both of those are willing to help us, and they're willing to give freely, the special gift to us to help us. And so we've got two cards right here. Before you leave today, I will encourage you to come and sign it. We want to give a card to both of those churches and tell them thank you for their willingness to give to help a sister church. New Life came and had baptism here last year with us. And we got them and worship together, if you remember that. And so I try to remember at the end of service, but if you haven't done so, feel free to put the sign card, put your name on there, and you thank the people who have given. You have given as well, and we could give a card out to everybody, but we'll be giving especially these two churches, so thank you as well. Also, today is Grandparents' Day, so I want to take this time to allow us to recognize our grandparents. If you are a grandparent, would you please stand? Y'all sure do look young to be grandparents. Y'all keep standing, don't see it.
Pastor Bobby, can we just stand if we want to be a grandparent?
Come on. You can watch our kids. Yes, or maybe you help raise kids that are not yours, they're about the grandparents. That's right. But what we want to do, we want to recognize each of your grandparents. We have a special gift for you. Our youth, our young people, our children want to come and help give these out. We have little journals you write in. You take notes of the preacher's message. You got a pen in there, and a pad, and a little leather type of thing. And we also have some journal books. So if we run out of these, we have journal books to give out as well. We have black, brown, and pink. So y'all come get these. If you'd rather have a journal, which is a plain hardback book, we've got those too. Once you get your gift, you feel free to have a seat. And those who want to be grandparents one day, you'll get a gift then. God who? What? Anybody ever kind of pondered or wondered about God and who He is and what He may look like and what it'll be like when we see Him face to face? Well, that's why you have a hand plugged up in the stream there, because we're not sure what God looks like. But we see characteristics of God that are molded through in our lives, but also through the example of Jesus Christ. And so, Jesus, basically, we're now in the next section of our passage where Jesus has a Q&A session. It was a Q&A where we're asking questions. Tony's saying, turn on my mic, let's go tail. There we go. So I can walk around. All right. John chapter 14, if you'll stay with me one more time, we'll read the verses 7 through 15. John 14, 7 through 15. And the Bible says, if you had known me, you would have known my Father also. And from now on, you know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is sufficient for us. Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Believe me that I am in the Father, and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Moses should then say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father. And whatsoever you ask in my name, that I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it. If you love me, keep my commandments. Let's pray. Father, we come to you today. We thank you again for this day. Thank you that we can come to worship. We do thank you again for our grandparents. We thank you for all our people, our families, our church family. We can come to meet together each and every week. And as we spend time in this word, may you be honored and glorified in everything that's said and done in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. May be seated. I call this the Q&A session because there was a time where the disciples had questions for Jesus. As you remember, these disciples had spent 3 years with Jesus. They got away from their jobs. They had left their investments on the sea. They left their mothers. They left their fathers. They left their brothers and sisters. They left all their plans aside and to follow the Lord. And after 3 years, they were thinking about him staying at the earthly kingdom in which they would rule with him. But then Jesus drops the bomb on them. And Jesus says, I won't be here much longer. I'm going to be killed. I'm going to die. And I'm going to heaven. Now, if you go back to the previous chapter, just a moment, the first question I have that we've dealt with is Peter. Peter was bold and brash, and he asked the first question in chapter 13, verse 36. And he says this, Simon Peter said to him, Lord, where are you going? Jesus answered, why I'm going, you cannot follow me, but you shall follow me afterward. Then we see Thomas in chapter 14, verse 5, which says, we preached on last week, because Thomas said to him, Lord, why do you not know where you were going? How can we know the way? Jesus talks about he's the way, the truth, and the life. And then so we're in this chapter, verse 7 and 8, we see verse 8, Philip asked a question, Lord, show us the Father, and is it sufficient for us? And so we see here, there's a lot of mixed emotions going on. All of a sudden, Jesus is preparing him to say, I'm about to leave this world, I'm about to go back to be with the Father. And everything's getting turned over. And so Philip's desire was a good one. We all want to see the Father. What's the Father look like? Is he is he real to us? Throughout scriptures, we know the Old Testament people who were walking with God. They saw God by a cloud by day, fire by night in the wilderness. They saw the glory of God and Moses on Mount Sinai. And in other places, the transfiguration, we see pictures, or so forth, individuals in the presence of God. the burning bush. Moses, of course, the burning bush. People kind of know, what does God look like? What does God like? And Jesus is trying to say, hey, what you see here is what you get there. The apple that falls apart from the tree, right? And so, one of the words that we see here is know. Where you have known, verse 7, me. And throughout this passage, throughout the book of John, there's the word know. We see the word know. It's mentioned 131 times throughout the Gospel of John. Now, when we talk about the word know, there's four different ways to think of the word know. First of all, the word know is to knowing facts. We know facts, head knowledge. Okay? So it's like knowing 2 plus 2, 3 plus 3, 4 plus 4. You should know those, right? 1 times 1 is what? 2? All right. So knowing facts. The second type of knowledge that is known is knowing the truth behind the facts. Let's say you know of a story that was written up in the paper. Well, you know about it, but you really know about it if you were there as a witness. You saw it. And so there's a deeper meaning sometimes in scriptures of the word know. There's also the word knowing in the aspect of knowing the truth behind the facts in a personal way. Basically, maybe something that happened to you personally and directly, a heart knowledge, knowing the truth behind the facts of the story. And then there's also the last one is this, knowing the truth behind the facts personally and intimately, and deeper knowing. Many of you know the Queen of England, right? Who knows who the Queen of England is? Okay, you raise hands. Who is it? All right. The Queen of England is Queen Elizabeth, right? Who knows her? I know about her. I know maybe some facts about her. Some people who are closer, who work with her daily, know about her. But her family, her husband, probably really knows her in an intimate way, in other ways, not only physically, emotionally, spiritually, and all those things, right? And so there's a different, when we see the word know in the scriptures, it is a, can have a, one of these meanings. Here we see the word know as a knowing Christ in a personal, intimate, close relationship. Remember, these guys have been with Jesus for 3 years, okay? They should know what his likes. They probably know his favorite color. What's Jesus' favorite color? I'm just teasing. You know, sometimes we know little things about someone more than a personal thing. But I say royal purple, don't worry. I don't know. But here's the thing. John, James, and Peter, they probably knew Jesus a lot closer than Thaddeus and Philip and Judas, you know, that kind of thing, right? But they were still closer. The more you spend time with God, the closer you know him. So the question is this, as our title is, making God more real in your life. How do you make God more real? You got to know him. First of all, you got to know him in your heart through Jesus Christ. You got to know, not just a head knowledge. Everybody knows about Jesus. People hear about Jesus, hear about God, know, right? What's the devil say? What's the Bible say about the devil? James chapter, I think chapter 2 or 3, where it says, even the demons and the and know of Jesus. But in order to understand and be closer to God, to have a more personal relationship with God, we first got to go beyond the head knowledge of just knowing about him to our heart knowledge. And then when we get that heart knowledge, the more time we spend with God, the more intimate we become with God, the more we understand God and do his will, the less we do of our own mess or our own worldliness. And therefore, we become to know him behind the facts personally, intimately, in the deepest heart knowledge possible. Okay? So, let's give you some examples here. The first level of knowledge, some of you maybe this, maybe you were dating. You had Google eyes, you had your eyes, someone looking at them and kind of giving the eye. Ooh, she looks good. Right? That's kind of just a basic knowledge. And then when you start going on a date, you start talking, you start sharing about brothers and sisters, you start meeting the parents,
and things like that. It kind of, it's more of a getting to know even better. And then we would know the third level of knowledge up there, knowing them personally, you know, the likes, dislikes, you know, you put effort, you do things for them. And then the last thing is basically, if you have children, you know what that is? You're intimate, emotionally, spiritually, physically, socially, and all that. So you can kind of see that level of relationship. But what about Jesus? We can have that kind of relationship, an intimate relationship with God as a way of, we get to know, he can talk to us, communicate. Because in the garden, you know that song in the garden? And he walked with me and talked with me? That's right. And so we can have that relationship. We can know God's will. We can have, to understand God and experience God being real in our lives in a personal way. All right? Now, I'll give you 3 points. Number one, in this passage, we see the meaningful request. When Philip was asking Jesus this question, it was very meaningful. We all want to know what God is like. We all are going to simply know, understand God better. And here we see Philip the same thing. The longer we are saved, the more our desires change. Hopefully. We should become more interested in the things of God and less in things of ourselves. We should have a desire to our focus should be on God. Our focus, our daily walk in life, we should see the presence of God in our lives. Doesn't mean you have to be a holy roller. Doesn't mean you have to be an evangelist or preacher. But hopefully people can see God in your life by the way you live, act, and do, and dress, and speak, and all these things. And they see God's in our eyes. So Philip had a great desire. He wanted to understand. And he wanted to understand who Jesus was physically. We all say, we want to see him physically. The world wants to see Jesus with their own eyes, physically. But we can't. It takes faith, spiritual. We need to spiritualize. And so, here we see this, Philip. His desire was sincere, and he desired to know God, understand God, because his world is turning upside down. Jesus is leaving. The disciples are going to be a threat to society. Lives will be killed, and lives will be changed. Don't know what's ahead tomorrow. Usually when our life is in an uproar, a mess, we turn to God, we run away from God. We blame God, or we draw near to God. And God, are you real in my life? Where are you? And so we see this here. But we also see his need to see him physically. We will one day in his presence. Now, man's greatest need is to know God. In all questions, all issues in life, there's the greatest thing, the greatest question, the greatest thing that matters in this life is where we spend eternity, right? We make a decision who we marry, what we work, where we live, those kind of things. Those are go to school, and all that. Those are major things, decisions that change your life. But the greatest thing that changes your life is our eternal destination, life after death. And so knowing God is meaningful. This is a meaningful request. Secondly, we see the master's reply. Here's Jesus' reply to Philip. Look at verse number 9. It says, Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you so long, and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, show us the Father?" This is kind of a mild review, getting whoo. You ever had a teacher, when you ask a question, the teacher kind of gives you a response, wait a minute. Not necessarily, every question is a good question. You ask a question, I'll answer. But some people think, whether it's a teacher or not, some people think, you know, some questions are kind of just a waste of time. You know what I mean? Am I the only one? Am I fair? Anyone here? Hello? Sometimes people think, well, that's a silly question. But, you know, here we see Jesus give him a rebuke in a sense that, ooh, kind of step on your toes. I don't understand. And Jesus kind of teaches him a lesson here. And says, he's saying, not just to Philip, but he's saying all of them. He spent all this time with me for 3 years, and he still don't know who I am. Don't understand that I am with my Father, and my Father is of me. Jesus makes it clear that through him, that we go to the Father. Remember what's the thing of John? What's the thing of John? To show that Jesus is God. Therefore, if Jesus here says, you can only go to the Father but through him, John 14, verse 6. And so therefore, we see that Jesus is God. He is an image of God. And what we see of Jesus can be seen of God. Now, it's kind of interesting, though, to notice this. Because people want to see God physically with their own eyes, they can't see him spiritually or trust by faith, they want to make gods. Look in Romans chapter 1, the Bible says this, verse 20, for since the creation of the world has invisible attributes, which is attributes of God are invisible and are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, that they are without excuse, because they also knew God, did not glorify him as God, nor were thankful to him, but because for futile their thoughts, their foolish hearts were darkened. Professing to be wise, they became fools, changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like corruptible man, and birds, four-footed animals, and creeping things. So we see here, people are searching out for a God, and they would rather worship a thing that they can see rather than the things they cannot see, the invisible attributes of God and his presence and his effects upon us. Now, how do you see God in Christ? Preacher, how do you see God in Christ? Well, we see God through the words that he speaks. We see God through the words that he speaks. Look at verse 10. Do you not believe that I am the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does the works. Let me give you an example. What if one of my boys, it's okay, Joe, the preacher kids get picked on them, they get to use the illustrations. And I hear about it later usually, but that's all right. My son's already doing it already. What if my oldest son, Joel, said, Benjamin, go clean up your room. And Benjamin says, you're not the boss of me. Can you see that? And then Joey says, Daddy told you to do it. It carries weight if Daddy means it, right? If I said, Joey, go tell your brother to clean up his room. More likely, he might listen a little bit better because it carries weight, right? But if Joey was just saying it to Benjamin, they, you might forget it. Right? Same way with the words from our Father, God. When God's Word speaks, it carries weight and authority. And then when we listen to what it says, to the way he speaks, we also see the God in Christ through the works that he does. Look at verse 11, the rest part of verse 11. To believe me that I am the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. How do we see God through Christ Jesus? Through the works. What's Luke 19:10 say? When the Son of Man comes to seek and save that which is lost. That's right. Come to seek that which is lost. And so we see the works of Jesus, the miracles that he did. We see the people who were lame that were healed through the book of the Gospel of John. We see Lazarus rise from the dead. We see other Gospels where Jesus walked on water. We see calming of storms and all these miracles. These were works done through the power of God through Jesus. The God allowed to happen. So we see the Father and the Son through the works. When Jesus healed the sick, we see the mercy of God. But Isaiah 53:5 says this, "For the stripes we are healed." And so Jesus healed us spiritually from the stripes and the bruises and the death that he did on the cross for us. When Jesus calmed the storms, we see the power of God through Jesus. When Jesus lived sinlessly his entire life, we see the holiness of God. God is holy, pure. When we see Jesus had fellowship with sinners, he ate with the sinners, the publican, all these people. And yet that shows the grace of God, God's grace. We also see that Jesus died on the cross, and that shows the love of God. So all these attributes that we see from Jesus come from who? God. Come from God. Alright? Jesus shows us the Father through his words and his works. Through his words that he speaks come from God and from his works. Now, the third thing is this. The magnificent revelation. Here's our application for today. How do we experience God that's real in our life on a daily basis? How do we keep God from being up there in heaven and us down here, feeling like we're apart, wondering if there is a God, wondering if God's going to help us? And are we wasting our time coming to church? Are we wasting our time doing things for God? Are we wasting our time giving our gifts and our tithes? Are we wasting time of praying and all these things? Here is the application point, the magnificent revelation, verse 12. He says, "Most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these that he will do, because I go to my Father." First of all, we see as believers, if we truly believe, it says if we believe who he is, that he is Jesus, that he is God, and therefore we trust him, we give our lives to him, we accept Christ, we serve Christ, we will do the works for God even greater. Now let me ask this question. Can we really do the works of God greater than he did himself? If we had the same, if he had the same amount of time we had and had the same kind of people to run into and society and internet and all these other things we have, he might do greater things. But he only had a short period of time. He had 3 years. We have a lifetime. Hopefully we have more than 3 years. Anybody more than three? All right. So, not in quality, but in quantity, we do. When in the book of Acts, the day of Pentecost, with over 3,000 were saved at one point in time. We see other examples of people being saved across the world. We see people like Billy Graham, who gave his life and reached many souls for the Lord. We don't have the same quality as being holy and being like God, but quantity, time, and impact, and people, we can do much better things through the power of the Holy Spirit within us. Therefore, that's why it says here in verse 12, it says, "I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than those he will do, because I go to my Father." We have a greater impact through the influence of the Father through the Holy Spirit. We can reach people, continue to reach people, and help people, and meet needs. You say, "How do you do that, preacher?" I see this. We're willing to work for the Lord. Willing to serve. Serve the Lord. What's your gift? What's your ability? Where do you want to serve? Where do you serve? Where do you serve in the church? Where do you serve in the community? Where do you serve in your home? What do you do for the Lord to make a greater impact for others? Also, our prayer life. We see your prayer, verse 13 to 14. "And whatever you ask in my name that I will do, the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you ask anything in my name, I will do it." Prayer. How do we have God being a more important role in our life and being more meaningful for us? By doing works for him, serving him, by praying. not just simple little prayers, like our blessing prayers or good morning prayers or good night prayers, but intercessory prayer. Pray on behalf of others. Pray for God's will. Pray for God to work a supernatural thing in the situation. Prayer. That's John 5:14. And this is a confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. Now, some people ask this question in this verse 14. It says, if I pray for anything, does that mean I get anything I want? That's what it says, doesn't it? Throw that verse 14 back up there, Joey. There you go. It says, now this is the confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. Go to the next verse. Not 1 John. Go to our passage. That's right. That's part of it too. John 14:4. There you go. If you ask anything in My name, I will do it. If some people think that, assume that, okay, if I ask God for a Ferrari, that's what I'm going to get. If I ask God for a mansion, that's what I'm going to get. I will ask God for $1 million, win the lottery, and He'll give it to me. No, that's not. We take it out of context. You see, we've got to see the whole picture for what it is. When we are doing His work, and we are doing His will, then we can ask anything, and He will provide it for us. Because we're going to be doing what He wants us to do through His plan. That's why 1 John 5:14 says this, that if anything we ask according to His will, He will give it. Therefore, when we're doing His will, when we're serving, when we're praying, when we're coming to the Lord, our focus is not on the things that we want. Our focus is on things of God and what God needs and what we need for God to do in our lives. Our focus is different. Our perspective is different. But we also not only see a willingness to serve, prayer, but obedience. God's looking for obedient people. You want God to be more evident in your life and more meaningful and on your daily basis? Man, obey Him. Let me ask you a question. Were you a troubled kid or a good kid? Was life easy at home with you or not? Or did you receive rewards and gifts for doing good or being bad? Did your parents listen to you better when you were behaving or misbehaving? Were they willing to help you or do things for you when you were good or bad? Same with God. God wants to give you the blessings of all you can do. Everything is belongs to the Lord. He wants to bless you greatly. But if you don't listen to Him, why should He give them to you? You know, He does still. As parents, we sometimes give our kids things that they don't deserve. Because we love them, we still want to spoil them a little bit, maybe. But imagine if we obeyed what God said in His Word and did what it said, trusted God, what great blessings God bestowed upon our lives. Great blessings bestowed upon our lives. And then the last one is love. The first verse 15 there is love. If you love Me, keep My commandments. You obey by obeying His commandments, obeying the Scriptures, obeying His truths, doing what it says, but love Him. Love. Do you love the Lord? If you love the Lord, you'll serve Him. If you love the Lord, you will obey Him. If you love the Lord, you will do the works for Him. If you love the Lord, you'll put things of the Lord first and foremost. How do you make God more important in your life? We all have that desire to want to be closer to God, don't we? We all say, sometimes I feel like, some days I just feel like I'm a million miles away from God. And God's not listening to me. The other times I feel like, man, I can just hear God's voice. I can speak. I'm just on a mountain high. You ever been there? I don't know. God doesn't move. He doesn't change. He's always the same place, same way. It's us to move away from Him. If we want to have God have a greater impact in our lives and a meaningful life, and want God to really use us, and we want to experience God's blessings upon us, and we want to see God do great things through us and around us, and we make a difference for ourselves and others around us, debate God made before. We have to do these things. We got to obey. We got to follow Him. We got to love Him more. We got to love Him. What about you today? Is God important to you? He's supposed to be our first love. Church of Ephesus also is first love. And the things before God. How important is God to you? Oh, we come to you today. We thank you for all that you do for us. As we see these disciples, those questions, concerns about the future before them. There's many in this room today that question about tomorrow. They wonder about the things of above. They wonder about life after death. They wonder about an issue or trouble or problem that's going to happen. They don't know how to handle. They cry out to you. Say, God, help me. Where are you, God? God, help us to have that close, personal, knowing relationship with you, that are intimate. And where you can now we can begin to understand you better each and every day because of our discipline of prayer, of love, obedience, of serving, and all those things we've talked about today. We thank you for who you are. If there's someone here today that doesn't know Christ Jesus and Lord and Savior, they'll make walk this out and share with them what it means to be saved through your power. Be with us today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you please stand? We'll have the invitation. The altar's open from here. May God lead you to